Good evening. My name is Mayor Torrance Harvey, and City of Newburgh City Council is now in session, May the 13th, 2019. It is exactly 7 o'clock. It's now 7:01. We will start with a brief moment of silence. Then we'll go into our Pledge of Allegiance. After the Pledge of Allegiance, we'll do our roll call and communications. Please stand. Before we do our Pledge of Allegiance, I just want to take a couple more moments of silence because on May the 15th, 2018, our city was hit with a tragic tornado. And so the 15th will be Wednesday on 2 days. And so we want to think about the young lady who lost her life in the city of Newburgh. We had one fatality. And we also had a fatality in the town of Newburgh. And for those families and for those that were tragically struck by the tornado almost a year ago, we want to have a brief moment of silence for that as well. Thank you. I pledge my allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice.
Present.
Councilwoman Mejia.
Here.
Councilwoman Monteverde.
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Here.
Councilman Squires?
Here.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Here.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes. Thank you. Next on the agenda, we're going to move to communications. We need an approval for the minutes of the City Council meeting on April 22nd, 2019. Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Squires?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes. Minutes approved. Okay, next we'll have the city manager's update.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Since our last meeting, city staff has continued to collaborate amongst itselves and obviously with the community, whether it's been working countless hours with Newburgh Illuminated for their upcoming event on June 1st, or the terrific partnership that we have with the Community Cleanup Day a few weeks ago, where more than 35 tons of debris were removed from the city with nearly 300 volunteers. And also special recognition to DPW and the Police Department for some collaboration on cleaning up a number of items, including the Ann Street parking lot, where there have been a wide range of issues there. In addition, DPW has also worked to repair four different sewer main and sinkholes since our last meeting. And the street sweeper has been out every day, obviously removing a number of debris from the street and also preparing for the upcoming paving, which will be starting in a few days. Milling will begin on Grand Street, Montgomery Street, Nicoll, Broad, and Clinton before the end of the week. Our engineering department has been working tremendously around the clock with lining the west end, the west trunk sewer main. As many of us know here, that main was first created about back in the late 1800s, and it speaks to the aging infrastructure throughout the city, and I want to applaud Jason for his efforts to line that main properly so that obviously discharges and breaks will not continue to happen in that region. Additionally, late on the evening of May 7th, the engineering department was notified by state DOT of a red flag issue with the Lake Drive Bridge. Obviously, we put the wheels in motion and we permanently closed that bridge. But thankfully, leading up to this day, we knew that there were a number of issues with that section of the bridge. So we've been preparing appropriately. So funding has been identified. The work has already been outlined. And we expect that construction will start before the end of the year to repair that bridge. I also want to give special recognition to our IT department, who's been able to supply a new backup alliance appliance server, rather, which will increase the city's recovery for up to 30 days as opposed to previously 10-day recovery periods. Nick and his team over at Information Technology are also preparing to implement Code Red, which is a reverse 911 system which the city will be using and to increase communication with the city. And obviously, IT, legal, corp counsel, our clerk, and others have been working for the to roll out of the municipal ID program, which we'll be hearing more about this evening. So far this year in the code enforcement office, we've issued nearly 700 permits, conducted nearly 2,000 inspections, issued well over 1,000 violations, and fielded over 800 complaints. Last but not least, our planning department. We have a new hire, Erin Cousins. She's serving as the neighborhood stabilization coordinator, and there was a lot of coordination among city staff to allow for that to happen. So I thank all those who are involved. It's a grant-funded position, which will work closely with a number of different departments to implement some more long-range planning revolving vacant and distressed properties, and also work to stabilize a number of different neighborhoods and equitably enforce the code throughout the city. And last but not least, Mr. Mayor, you know, we're very pleased to report that the city is in receipt of a number of different resumes for the Economic Development Committee. We expect in the near future we will be rolling out that committee and also immediately looking at a number of RFPs for land property sales, which will ultimately increase the tax rolls here. So far as my update is concerned, that pretty much concludes my remarks, and I turn the meeting back over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Donat. We really appreciate those updates. I'm really excited about all those particular items, particularly the Economic and Development Committee. We have a lot of great development ideas so to continue to revitalize our city. Next, we will move on to the agenda with presentations. I'm very, very excited to introduce, but not many, our Newburgh and Large City School District Superintendent, Dr. Roberto Padilla, and Mr. Ramjong and his staff. Please come forward, and we can have you either here or there, whichever you prefer. Yeah, we can have you here. We can get a mic there.
If I sit here, it's like I'm part of the team.
That's right. You're part of the team, sir. and if we could pull up his presentation, please.
So, Mayor Harvey and members of the council, city manager, I just want to thank all of you for allowing just a little bit of your time this evening. I hear you're going to have a quick meeting tonight, so I don't want to delay your time. I do want to recognize two people from my team who are here with me, Mr. Roger Ramjug, who has been a very pivotal member of our facility steering team that has led to this amazing work, and then the newly minted Dr. Cassie, is what we call her, Dr. Cassie Sklars, who is one of our communication strategists. So, again, we're very appreciative to be in front of the council and the community to share some information regarding our budget for next year, as well as a very robust capital project plan that will go in front of the members of the community on Tuesday, May 21st. Is there a clicker?
Is there a clicker?
We'll give it a try. I don't know if
Yeah, if I have to move, it's fine. Should I move over there?
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so we are a district of approximately 12,000 scholars, and when we go to prepare the kind of budget that we have, it takes many, many months. It takes a lot of work analyzing our current data to determine the right needs and gaps for the subsequent year. So these are just a number of budget categories that we operate within when we begin to think about how to address the needs of our school system. I'm going to give you some high-level information tonight. I'm not going to dive deep into every single slide, but there are some things worth noting. We're the kind of school district in New York State. There are 705 school districts in the entire state. We are considered a comprehensive school district. We're one of a few 6-7 school districts in the state that are considered comprehensive school districts. And in a nutshell, that means that we are so comprehensive that we can offer many more programs than a lot of other districts. You'll see that in the way we offer our vocational programs. We're considered a non-component district. Which means that we can offer the program, we have the facilities in-house. Our kids don't lose instructional time transporting to Goshen or other districts to engage in various programs. What's also noteworthy is the budget-to-budget increases from year to year. So as you can see here, the governor releases his budget every January after the State of the State address. And that's the time districts across the entire state begin to learn an anticipated state aid run, which just means based on what was proposed, districts can then begin to drill down in their planning around what they can expect to receive in state aid. So as you can see here, the increase from last year is 3.7%, and that equates to just a shy over $6 million. I want to talk about this tax impact in some in this particular slide. So to our community, this slide should have significant reference. And part of what I want to capture in this slide is the kind of work that we're engaged in that sometimes just gets overlooked. So when you start to see budget-to-budget increases, right? So how does next year's budget increase from this year? We already know it's 3.7 at least based on the state
increase.
What determines one district getting $6 million and another district getting $1 million? Why does Middletown get this much and Newburgh or Port Service or other Mount Vernon get all this? And it's all based on need. We're a district with very specific needs that are different from some surrounding districts. So based on the children and the families in our district will determine the level of need in the form of
No, keep going.
Keep going, please.
Just some other quick points on the CT Center. Next year, we're bringing on holistic medicine. As you know, there are various medical tracks. There's the traditional medical track and growing fields in holistic alternative medicine that is not invasive. So we want to be able to give our children access to a growing field, and we'll be one of maybe the only district in all of their state that is launching that. We're launching a nutritional pathway in addition. So two new pathways next year for CTE. We want to demolish and reconstruct a 119-year-old section of the New England building. 3 years ago, we had to shut off sections of the building because it wasn't safe enough for students and teachers to be in. We had to move classes and students out of that building and put them in other schools because that space wasn't safe. So this project, specifically Proposition 4, addresses that. In 1975, the district and the community approved for temporary modulars at Vail Gate Senior Academy. It's 2019, and those modulars are still there. They have long lived their life and some. So we want to address that. At Heritage Middle School, children there eat lunch around 9 o'clock in the morning.
Wow.
That should sound very odd to you because that's not a time people should eat lunch. That's
right.
Breakfast time.
Right.
However, the building wasn't designed for a school. It's a beautiful building. And certainly we do amazing things there, but the cafeteria space just doesn't accommodate close to 950 students. So in order to get everyone fed, we need many more lunch periods. Therefore, children have to start that early. Proposition 5 speaks to air quality control. And so this is something that Mr. Ramdug speaks very passionately about. Think about this. If you were sitting in this space tonight and it was way too hot, and the air was just not moving, or you were sitting in a space that was just way too cold, you can't give your very best because you're going to be agitated. You're not going to be focused. You're not going to be able to concentrate at the task that that happens to children and adults when they're in spaces that are too hot, too cold, the air is stiff, it's not circulating well. And so this proposition, number 5, addresses air quality control systems across the entire district. What's the cause? So again, as it relates to our school budget, we get a lot of state aid based on our specific needs. Proposition 4 only requires a simple majority. And so that project is $198 million, of which $128 the district received state aid, leaving $60 million to taxpayers. Several years ago, we created a capital reserve fund and put $10 million into that. And so that allows us to stay within our bonding capacity. Proposition 5, as you can see, is $59 million, of which $45 million come back to the district. State aid, leaving $14 million to the taxpayers. Again, what's the impact on our taxpayers? 98 cents per $100,000 of full home value. Proposition 5 is 84 cents combined, $1.82 for every $100,000. That took us a lot of time. If we were not going to come to the community with such a robust plan that would heavily tax our community in order to get this work.
Thank you, Dr. Padilla. Thank you. Really excited about capital bond propositions 4 and 5, and very excited about the budget proposal and all the things that come along with it. And we truly thank the entire Newburgh and Lawrence City School District and Dr. Padilla and his executive staff. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Next, we'll go on to the next item in presentations, which is lead line replacement program. Mr. Vandenberg. Excellent. Excellent work.
Good evening.
Good evening. Good
evening. So about last 2 years now, obviously, you know, the city of Newburgh Water Department's been out, really been aggressive with fixing a lot of leaks and things of that nature. We found a lot of the leaks turned out to be lead service lines all across the city. As you know, the city of Newburgh, as per code, the homeowner owns the service from the main all the way into the house. So I was having a lot of homeowners almost crying in my office, and a couple times they were, that they had to spend up to $10,000 of their savings to replace their line. As part of working with the State Department of Health, the commissioner of the health department said, Wayne, how can we really help the citizen? And I said, one of the ways that we could really help the citizen and the citizens across the entire city would be a lead service line replacement program that would remove the lead out of the distribution system, but also create a pool of funding. So when we go through and we find lead services with our leaks, that we would able to assist the homeowner in funding for that replacement. Eliana, do you have my clicker? Does it work, Kern?
No.
You can click for me. Go ahead. So New York State Department of Health and the governor's office did come out with that program. And we were lucky enough to receive over $544,000 of grant funding for a two-year amount. Before Senator Larkin retired, he did call us and said, "How can I help?" And we said, "You know, we have the program. We just established the program. We didn't have a program like this before. That we could any more money that we could get, we could use." So he ended up giving us a check for $155,000 towards that program also. That program is to fund the replacement of a lead service line. It could be partial, it could be a full, for single family, multifamily, or mixed use. It's first come, first served basis. I'm just coming to report. Eliana, can you use the next one? We had 94 applications in about a year and a half that we received and approved. 85 of those were approved, and 44 lines were replaced as of last week. We still have the work ongoing. I just actually approved 2 today for funding, so that work is ongoing. We expect probably the work to be hopefully done by the end of the year, but you know we're out of funding as we speak. So we have an allotment of funding left that we for our approved contracts, but we're out. And I know Joe has been working with Assemblyman Jacobson and Senator Scroofa's office about getting more funding. I did reach out to the New York State Department of Health and said, you know, is this something that the governor is going to allot more money for? And we have heard rumor that yes, but that allotment hasn't been as of yet. So we're waiting on that, but we do have the program. It's up. It's ready. It's we put it through the test. It's done very, very well. I've actually had people come in crying in a really good way that they're so excited and happy that that we had the funding and things of that nature. So this has really, really affected a lot of residents and the city distribution system water quality because we've removed a lot of lead out of the system, and that's what we want to do. So it's been a really, really great program. Just in that, and, you know, she doesn't know this, but there's been three women, you know, I'm the face of it, but I haven't been doing the legwork. It's my administrative assistant, Diane McGraw, Helen Riley, our grants administrator, and Michelle Kelson. Without those three women, you know, they really built the program, they put it together, and they really ran the program. So without those three ladies, you know, the program really would never work. So thank you. Right. Eliana, I think I have one more slide just to kind of show the, you know, these are just some of the pictures all around the city. Obviously, I didn't have enough room to throw them all on, but, you know, as of right now, 44 homes, mixed-use or multifamily homes have brand-new copper services, you know, that the state paid for. Any questions? All right, guys. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Wayne.
Thank you.
Job well done, Wayne. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Vandenberg. We really appreciate the hard work and efforts of you, the department, and the ladies mentioned prior. I will definitely, along with our city manager and council, be lobbying for extra funding for this effort, because we definitely believe and support this program. Thank you so much. Next, we'll move on to comments from the public regarding agenda and general matters of the city. Please state your name, where you live, and you have 3 minutes. Thank you.
Public comment?
Public comments, please.
Stephen Mahano, 167 South William Street. I'm speaking on behalf of the City of Newburgh Democratic Committee. The City of Newburgh Democratic Committee issues the following statement of support. The City of Newburgh Democratic Committee unanimously supports the City Council's resolution to support the Protect Our Courts Act. The Protect Our Courts Act will prohibit federal immigration agents conducting courthouse raids and arrests of certain parties while going to, remaining at, or returning from court if the person is an interested party to such proceedings. Access to New York courts and to legal proceedings must not depend on place of birth, citizenship status, skin color, or indigence. The Protect Our Courts Act will allow domestic violence survivors to go to courts to seek protection without fear of arrest or raid by immigration agents. It will allow individuals facing criminal charges to have their fair day in court. It will allow parents too scared to attend child support proceedings to be present for their children. It will allow tenants to file actions against the landlords for grievances. Being so, the City of Newburgh Democratic Committee believes in the right to non-discriminatory courthouse access, and the Protect Our Courts Act is a key step in moving that access forward. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Bishop Terry Dorsey, and I live in the city of Newburgh, and I just want to do a prayer for the city of Newburgh. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. And we recognize, O Lord, who you are. Because besides you, there is no other. We are asking, O Lord, that you will look on the concerning citizens in the city of Newburgh, especially our leaders, O Lord. Touch their hearts, O Lord, that only you can. And help, O Lord, our leaders to understand how important it is to pray in the name of Jesus. And if you do that for us, Lord, we will be careful to give your name the glory, honor, and the praises. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Michelle Bash, resident and business owner in the city of Newburgh. I wanted to address the assessments. The tax assessments that came out generally in Ward 1 and Ward 2. There have been decreases in some instances. I recognize that, very few. Increases on an average of 20 to 25%, and in some cases up to almost 100%. On bills, on houses that work is happening on, and the work has not finished. Okay, my understanding from the work session was that the reassessments happen when the work has been finished. In two cases that I know of, the work has not been finished, and yet in one case it went up more than 100%. That is unconscionable, in my opinion. I find it also disingenuous to say that it's a good thing when the assessment goes up, because frankly, whether the assessment goes up or goes down, a house will be sold on open market at the perceived value, the assessment. Now, if the assessments keep on going up and the rates go up, but the city council says we want to have rent control, that doesn't work. You can't have rent control and have the cost for the landlords go up. You can't do both, because there's no way the landlord can eat that increase in their costs. It doesn't make any kind of sense. So I wish that the city council, the controller, and everyone here will please understand that we as citizens in this city, who we love this city and have been here and have spent time, have spent work, have spent money, and are here because we care, not because this city gives a lot back. It takes a lot, but we see a vision in it. And frankly, it seems that it is the few that are paying for the many, and we have to find a way of getting the many to pay for the many and not the few for the many. And it seems to be a rotating game every year. It just keeps on happening. This council is very good. You work together, but you have to work with us and for us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, good evening. My name is Jacob Kupart. I'm here representing the office of Assemblymember Jonathan Jacobson. He just would like to say that he co-sponsors the Protect Our Courts Act, which is Assembly Bill 2176, and he would just like to briefly explain his position. We need to encourage all residents to fully participate in making our communities safer. If a resident is a witness to a crime, we want that resident to report the crime, fully cooperate with the police and the district attorney office, and testify as a witness if necessary. We want all residents to report to the police and the courts if he or she is a victim of domestic violence, for example. If the resident is fearful of being arrested, this will not happen. This bill makes us safer for us all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Renee Mejia. I live at 458 First Street. So I'm up here again once, you know, just like everyone, asking that you guys support the resolution for Protect Our Courts. I think that the people before me have made a great point, and I just want to elaborate on it. Well, not elaborate, but, you know, just once again to say. But mainly I'm here also as a member of Nobody Leaves But Hudson to ask if we can get a bit more of an update on what's going on with the municipal IDs, you know, if there's a set month yet. And we also want to extend, you know, our assistance if there's an obstacle that you guys found that is something challenging that you guys might need the assistance of the community for, or maybe Nobody Leaves But Hudson itself. We want to extend our hand and make sure that we can help you guys along the way. I know that a lot of our members have been coming to us, especially with some concerns. Apparently there's been talk about the ID already being given out, and some of the members have come to us saying, hey, I just gave this person my information and some money, and I haven't gotten my ID yet. So the more informed that I am, the better I can assist my members and make sure that things like that don't happen, because we all know people like to take advantage of people in situations like this. And once again, if there's anything I can do or Nobody Leaves But Hudson can do to help you guys overcome any obstacles, that would be great.
Hola, Tomás le estaba diciendo que queremos que nos actualicen un poquito más sobre las identificaciones municipales, de qué es lo que está pasando. También dejarles saber que nosotros lo queremos lo más pronto posible, porque hay gente que está tratando de aprovecharse de nosotros ahorita en estas situaciones, pidiéndonos dinero o documentos para que las saquemos más rápido. Pero cuando nosotros sabemos que los únicos que nos las pueden dar son ellos, y nosotros también, como miembros de Nadine Sebadimir Hudson, queremos ayudarle lo mejor que podamos. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Mejia.
Hi, Hannah Brooks. I'm here to make a few comments with regard to the recent assessments. I would first like to preface my comments with just a statement, which is some materials that I have sent earlier to some members of the council. The mayor sat with the assessor, worked with other people. These are only observations, not accusations. So please, let's all take it in that spirit. We really just all trying to work together. So basically, I just want to mention that I and others have taken the time to systematically review city as a whole, but in my case, really going through property by property in my neighborhood. I took this on because I had noticed with new people coming into the neighborhood a few years ago, that some young couples were being unduly burdened by their assessments and taxes, to the point where even on one block, two homes sold within a couple of years of each other. There's a lot of moving parts when it comes to assessment. Nobody disagrees with that. The assessor's job is very hard. I spent some time studying it and speaking with other people more knowledgeable. And ultimately, it's important when we have conversations to understand how these decisions are made so we have intelligent conversations about them. So ultimately, we can speak the same language and make some good changes. Basically, I'm concerned about a lack of uniformity and equitability, especially for the single property homeowners. I think that there seem to be some patterns of assessments being raised on properties that have recently been purchased compared with others. There are homestead properties that are single family that appear to be assessed at higher values for many reasons compared with multifamily homestead properties. And finally, there are inequities in properties citywide. The result is that we're starting to see single family homeowners bearing the greatest tax burden. These are the backbone of our city. These are the people who are coming here to put down roots, and these are the people who are opening businesses. And I think if we don't pay attention to the impacts that these assessments have on that particular group of people, we're going to see a lot of churning again and a lot of instability again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ignacio Acevedo, lead organizer for Nova Lisbon Hudson, 123 Washington Street. Ignacio Acevedo, el organizador principal de Nadie Se Va de Hudson, 123 Washington Street. I'm just here also in support of keeping our courts safe and protect our courts, and also just to get an update on the municipal ID and how we can support this process. And I know we're all working hard on that. So aquí estoy en apoyo de mantener nuestras cortes protegidas, y también quiero saber un poquito más de los el progreso de las IDs. I'm with us and here in our audience, we have a family member, a family who are going through a scary situation. Their landlord is scaring them every day with letters of getting them evicted, even though they paid the rent, even though they've been there for a while. It raised their rent from $800 to $1,200 overnight, and it wants them out immediately. So, and this is just one story that I'm sharing, but there's many more that are coming to us now. So I think, especially with the fear of immigration and those threats, this is how they're terrorizing them. So estoy aquí también para contar una historia, que aquí tenemos compañeros que están viviendo una situación de terror porque su rentador los está amenazando de querer sacarlos. Le subieron la renta de 800 a 1,200 en una noche. Viven en peligro. Los amenazan. So yo vengo también aquí a abogar para que eso pare. So this is happening in William Street, which one of our city council members covers South William Street. Okay, so ¿quién de nuestros representadores cubre South William Street? Creo que las dos personas alzaron sus manos. I'd like to know, like, what can we do? What should they do? Yo quiero saber qué es lo que nuestros compañeros pueden hacer en un caso como este. ¿Cómo se pueden defender? How can they defend themselves? They're living in a fear of, they have no information, that they're being threatened every day, so what do they do? Todas nuestras, esta comunidad y específicamente esta familia está viviendo en terror todos los días por las amenazas. ¿Qué es lo que pueden hacer? ¿Con quién deben de hablar?
Los familias necesita un contrato con la landlord para la casa y los gentes necesita un abogado para eso también, ¿entiende? So es una ¿cómo se dice lo? Un abogados, los abogados en la oficina de legal services of the Hudson Valley, mm-hmm. No cuesta nada dinero para eso. No necesita dinero para los abogados en la oficina de Legal Services of the Hudson Valley. Y los gentes en la oficina de abogado de Legal Services of Hudson Valley, mucha gente habla en español también. Okay.
Ignacio, I'll talk to you afterwards. I got an email today from somebody. Not sure it's the same person. I haven't heard back. Right. So I will talk to you about that. And there's some things that can happen right away.
Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias.
Mari Shakur, 55 Liberty Street. You're talking about them rents and stuff going up. We're going up to Albany tomorrow and talk to Scoofus and Jacobson because both of them said that they were going to sign off on the good cause resolution that they have going forth. But now they're kind of waffling back and forth, so we're just going up there to talk to them tomorrow about it. But we also want the city council, because the city council, y'all signed off on the good cause, right?
Yes.
So if you can give them calls and not let them understand, because we're going to be calling their offices, we're setting up phones now to call Scoofus and Jacobson after we go see them tomorrow. So we're taking the bus up there tomorrow, and we're going to go see them, because we're not going to talk about stuff. We're going to make sure that they see us up there. So also, we wanted to talk about Saul Williams Church up on the corner of Broadway and William Street. Mm-hmm. And I think that used to be Moulton Memorial, so it's a historical building. But Mr. Chet, the former head of the NAACP, had stopped me the other day and was talking to me about it, that they're trying to put a sign up there, one of those...
Yeah.
So I told him I didn't know what was going on. I'm not on the city council yet, so I told them I did not know what was going on, but I will come down and see if I could find out and get any information about that.
Yeah, well, I had been working with them when Reverend Williams was on, right. Was a pastor before the interim pastor, Mrs. Sister Briggs.
Dr. Briggs.
Yeah, Newkirk Briggs. Right. She's the interim pastor, but I have been working with Pastor Byron Williams, and what happened was they went before the planning board. And because it's in the historical district, they purchased the sign before they went before the planning board. Gotcha. For approval. And so there was nothing, so they didn't get approved because it's the historical district, and there was nothing they could do, but they had already spent a lot of money on this sign. They're henceforth is sitting in front of the church currently.
Okay, so I was supposed to meet one of them here tonight, that's why I came down. Because I told them possibly y'all can redo it or something?
Well, the only thing that we can do is talk to our corporate counsel and see if there's any legal maneuvering that can happen between the city and the planning board, but I don't think there is.
Okay, I'll send that back to them. So, man, my last thing is, before my 28 minutes or seconds is up, the weather. Who do I contact about the weather? The weather, man. It's well, one cold. Who do I talk to? Is it George?
He sits up high and looks
about
down
the
low.
Weather, because the weather is kind of
it is.
Here
it
for
really
me.
Is.
So thank you for that information.
Thank you.
Good evening, Tom Roberts, Central Avenue.
Hi, Tom.
There's a lot I wanted to say tonight. It wouldn't have been very nice, but I'm just going to say how I feel. I always have. I felt that the city council should have come up and had some kind of meetings with people who were interested to find out about this reassessment. A lot of people don't understand this. You know, to them and to me, the bottom line is dollars and cents. okay? I get a paper in the mail, I'm getting reassessed at 30.75% on my property. I also have an extension in my backyard, which I'm being reassessed at 621%. Now, my backyard, the extension, is full of trees and grass, and I'm going to be reassessed at 621%. From $1,900 up to $13,000-something. Doesn't seem like a lot of money to people. It's $400 or $500. But I have to tell you, that along with my property on Central, a 30-point-something, it comes out probably $3,500 worth. People like me are, maybe some people can come up with this money, but I'm on Social Security. My wife and I, we're residents of the city for 18 years now, and there's a lot of people like me that are just have their heads above water. I don't understand how the city council, I'll say it again, just did not come out with some meetings to explain this, because I got to be honest with you, I don't understand all this assessment stuff. I understand it's good and everything, but to me, at the end of the day, it's taking money out of my pockets. Originally, we said there was going to be no more taxes and stuff this year and everything. We all felt good about it. Now we're getting hit with this, and to me, again, it's just dollars and cents, and that's all we see, and not just me. Some of my friends are being, you know, their assessments are going up 30, 40, 50%. I have one neighbor that it's doubling. Their assessment is doubling. I mean, where are people supposed to get the money for that? I just wish you people would have gone through things and used a different route and to at least have meetings to explain stuff to people. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Roberts.
Hello. My name is Carla Johnson. Community Voices Heard, New Voters Movement, Civic Engagement Table. We spend a lot of, you guys made a resolution for a good cause for us tenants in the city of Newburgh. I'm a little confused because Jonathan Jacobson sat on this board with you guys as a city council member. I worked very hard getting people out to vote for him, numerous phone calls for him, and now or something, he's not for good cause. So I just want to let people know that we're going to Albany tomorrow to his office, and if they would like to come, we're leaving at 7:30 in the morning. James Schoolfitz, which I found out he was from the same neighborhood I'm from in Queens, and he should be on the good cause movement because where he comes from. But he's going to sign off on good cause, but I'm just a little concerned about Jonathan Jacobson. If you guys made the resolution and y'all want to go forward with it, I don't understand why he's not on the same page. When we was in Albany about 2 months ago at his office doing housing stuff, and he was like, oh yeah, I think it's going to be a good idea, and then now all of a sudden he's not for it. So I just wanted to put that out there that tomorrow at 7:30 in the morning, we leave it from our CVH office at 377 Broadway to go to Albany to demand to speak to Jonathan Jacobson on why he doesn't want good cause for the city of Newburgh. Good cause is just, it's not going to have anything to do with raising the rents with the landlords. It's just going to secure families and their residents. So if you go and make a complaint at 123, I think, Grand Street Codes Enforcement. So if I go make a complaint against my landlord can't put me out. So that's a part of the good cause. If the landlord needs to make repairs on the building and he may need to raise the rent a little bit, they still gonna be able to raise the rent, but they just not gonna be able to put us out so quickly. And good cause is just, if you don't pay your rent, yeah, you could get put out. If you damage a landlord's property, yes, you could get put out. But you will not be put out if you made a cold complaint. You will not be retaliated. That's what they do here in the city of Newburgh. If you got mold, you complain about it, you get put out. If you got a rotten problem, you complain about it, you get put out. Tenant protection, I mean, good cause is just protecting us tenants so that we don't have to keep moving and relocating. So if you speak to Jonathan Jacobson, you should ask him, like, hey, you sat here on the board with us. Why we passed the resolution, why you not down with good cause?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so that concludes our public comment segment of our agenda, and now we'll hear comments from the City Council regarding the agenda and general matters of the city. We'll start with Councilman Grice.
Okay, thank you. First of all, I want to thank everyone that came out tonight. I'm going to try to get through everything, but if I don't...
We got responses for y'all. Yeah. You guys are leaving, yeah. Okay.
You got an end to my time?
I'm sorry. My apology.
So the Protect Our Courts Act, I'm very proud that Councilmember Monteverde brought that forward. I look forward to supporting that. Another resolution that I'm very excited about is the paper carryout bag fee. And so when that resolution comes up, I'll speak to that more directly. The Code Red, Reverse 911, I'm very excited about that. So I look forward to that. We just put out a press release about paving our streets, so I would like to remind Mr. Garrison and our DPW that we have a complete streets guide, so if we can use that as when we're paving and striping and doing those other things, that would be great. On June 8th, I'm very proud to be working with the Hudson Valley DSA, Community Voices Heard, and the Civic Engagement organization. We will be doing a free brake light replacement that's going to be on June 8th in the Ann Street parking lot from 11 to 3. So if you know anyone who might need their brake light replaced, we will be doing that for free. So please come and attend that. Also, I guess it's no secret at this point that a lot of us either work for the school district or we worked with the school district or our parents or our loved ones or someone there. So I'm very happy about that bond that's coming forth. I look forward to that. So the final thing that I want to talk about, I'm a single family homeowner. My assessment value went up as well. What I think that we do need is perhaps a citywide reevaluation. We have to make sure that even if it's not inequitable, that it doesn't have the appearance of being inequitable. I agree we should get out more and have some more workshops just to build everybody up with their capacity about the difference between assessments and between taxes. So that's what I'll be looking for. I think that as a city, we need to do a better job at collecting all of our revenues. The other thing Mr. Donat and I have spoken about intensely is getting a communication strategist, someone that will be able to tell our story. So I look forward to that happening very soon, I hope.
Hopefully so.
Okay, and then in my last few minutes, Census 2020.
Thank you, Councilman Grice. Right. Councilwoman Mejia.
So I'll try not to repeat what Councilmember Grice had said, but just one that's important and bears good to repeat is the support for the Protect Our Courts Act. And I would dare say, you know, it should go further than just Protect Our Courts Act. It should be Protect our communities, because when you talk about the example that was given around eviction, the rent increase from 800 to 1200 and what can be done for population that is here in the city of Newburgh, you know, we get countless of calls and emails about folks reaching out when they've come up to a mic and express their concerns about their housing situations, and they're on a month-to-month lease. Everybody is within their rights to go ahead and do that. Having the slate of tenant protection legislation that's currently being debated in Albany is not to deter the private market from doing what the private market does. It is to strike a balance so that communities like ours can remain as diverse as possible. So when we equate rent control, you have to paint the full picture about that. Closing out the loop on the just cost eviction and the rent control, it just means that you can't go from 800 to 1200 in a 24-hour period. And if you are part of our community that is not suffering through that, then you are blessed and it's great that you're not, but there's a huge portion of our community who are facing that on a day-to-day basis. to Mr. Acevedo, who raised what can be done for families that are encountering this. Legal Hudson Valley Services is one of the options, but they are so swamped with it. I know that a lot of it takes place in the informal market as to who has apartments that are available. So those are the types of calls that a lot of us as council members vet, and that we are trying to work with our codes department so that everybody knows what type of apartment you're getting into. And again, it's about having a more open government, transparent about it. Around the assessments, there is a grievance process, and I would encourage everyone to follow that grievance process. The deadline is coming up at the end of the month for it, and you know that is one of the avenue process for it. Again, as a taxpayer myself and a resident, us as council members also face the same things that all of us are facing when it comes to our rent increases, and it's just a delicate balance. So that's all the comments. Let me see, just make sure on you. Councilmember Grice said census 2020 multiple times, and there'll be a lot of information, and the most important thing to do is to fill out the census. And more community groups will be based upon that. You'll see it on our banners as well. We'll have links on the website. But again, that's also part of making sure that the city of Newburgh as a municipality gets the funding that it's required and that it deserves based on our population. Thank you.
Thank you. Perfect timing. Councilperson Monteverdi.
Good evening. Thanks for coming out on this awful cold night. I just want to make a couple of comments on a couple of things. And I probably have missed what everybody has already said, but I want to just make sure. I know that we're shooting for early summer to get those municipal IDs going, right? So we'll keep talking about it and continue to communicate to the public, you know, when we're about ready to get ready to distribute the municipal IDs. And it will be on our website. We'll put it out on social media. So please.
Flyers.
Yes, flyers as well. Do not give your money to anybody who is not affiliated with the city of Newburgh City Hall, who is not a staff or a council member. Please don't do that. People are going to take advantage of and use this opportunity to take advantage of folks. So hold on to your money, and we'll get the word out to you shortly. I'm very excited tonight about the fact that we're about to pass the resolution on Protect Our Courts. This is something that I feel very strongly about. I feel like we have to continue to protect our community because of what's going on in the world today and what that person in Washington, D.C. has instigated in this world today, which is nothing but hate. In this community, we are welcoming. We do not hate. We protect our citizens. We are welcoming, and we will continue to do whatever we can to make sure that, you know, on the local level, we protect everybody. So thanks again for coming out tonight. There's other things that I want to talk about, but I can wait to the end. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilwoman Rayford.
Thank you. I want to thank Bishop Dorsey for that wonderful prayer. I want to talk about the forensic audit that had been voted on years ago, and somehow we still can't find the money. But I can recall that our former comptroller was arrested and brought out of this place by stealing from the city of Newburgh. So I was hoping that this forensic audit be done, that other people that has been stealing from the city of Newburgh be brought out of here in cuffs as well. I said that because I was done wrong as a council member. They tried to bully me, but I'm not going nowhere. Let God handle it because it's in his hands. I want to support the good cause movement. I also want to know what landlords are holding these people I guess that's a bully tactic as well as, you know, too. You know, you go and call on your landlord because your apartment or your house is not up to code, and now you got to get out. So, you know, if you can call one of us here on council, we want to know who these landlords are. Yeah, we want to know. And then also, we want you to come out and vote May 21st this month for the capital bond for the school district, because our buildings, they do need help, just like our city municipality buildings, they need help too. And also the Protect Our Courts Act, I do support it, and I do want to thank our Councilwoman Ramona Monteverde for bringing that to our attention. I am supportive of this. And I just say to the people, don't be afraid. We are your friends. Come talk to us, and we'll help the best we can. God bless you.
Thank you. Councilman Sklarz.
Thank you all for coming out tonight. I had the pleasure this past Saturday of having a tour of the water treatment facility in Browns Pond. I encourage you all to spend a few hours. I think tours are often offered once a month. It's a really worthwhile tour. Wayne, I had a chance to talk to your mentor, your predecessor, for quite a while that day, and I can see where the pride and professionalism of your department comes from, and it's carried on through you and the work of your staff. To me, the word pond conjures up things that are less than desirable. When I walked out and saw Brown's Pond, and it's a reservoir, and it's pristine, and it's beautiful, we need to come up with another name for our water treatment, our water source, because it is really stunning. It's the first time I've ever been out there. On the Protect Our Courts Act, let me see if I can get this open now. We've passed two resolutions, one on a safe and welcoming city and the other one on the ID plan. This, to me, I think, is the most important of them all. I read an article in The Nation magazine. I just want to read you a quote. Courtrooms are a unique public space, a place to which people of all backgrounds can turn up to keep their families safe or to hold landlords, bosses, or their governments accountable for respecting their rights. When ICE strikes these sacrosanct spaces, it's not only a violation of personal dignity, but also an assault on the social fabric, an attack on the pursuit of justice that makes life possible. This is a very critical vote, and I'd be proud to cast my vote yes. That's all.
Thank you. Councilwoman Sophocles.
Hi, everyone. I'm not going to talk. I support the act as well, but I want to thank Dr. Padilla for being here tonight, because our school district is very important for everybody here, whether you have children in the school, mine are grown up. My mother was a teacher in the district for 38 years. So as they said before, everybody's touched by the school district. We want to support it. So remember to go out and vote May 21st. I'm not going to talk about everything else they spoke about. I think everybody gets the idea that we support all of these things. But I do want to say one thing, that this Wednesday and Thursday, when you drive by Downing Park, finally, the monument will be going back up so that the veterans will be happy. It was run over after being there for 60 years, unfortunately, the gentleman didn't have enough insurance, so we've had to raise money and get grants, and Scartatos' office supported it. And I'd also like to thank Helen Riley and her department, because they've been instrumental in getting this monument up. But keep an eye out that George, and thank you, George, for pouring the base. The base is poured, so they're coming on Wednesday, right, George? Wednesday and Thursday, I think, this week. So keep an eye, and it'll be up for Memorial Day. So everybody take a visit and thank your veterans.
Thank you. So I don't know if Councilwoman Sophocles is yielding her time to me. No, just kidding, JK. But yeah, I want to first say thank you to everyone that came out tonight. Your presence is very important. Mr. Tom Roberts, I really appreciate your comments regarding the city council and what we could do. I just want to make you aware, Joanne Mazuski is our tax assessor, and she was here Thursday at our work session, and we invited her because a lot of us on the council received phone calls. We got text messages, emails, and then about the assessments, particularly even on social media. The comments that I had made was that a lot of our city properties are increasing in value, and I've looked at a number of residents and I've met with people one-on-one. The market is turning, not only in America, but particularly in Newburgh. Our property values have gone up in just 1 year. If you look at where we were in 2008, many of our properties were underwater. My property value went from 255 to 96,000 and had to refinance, and then it was the Obama HARP program that I had to get into, and at a fixed 2% interest rate, and then they wipe away a lot of your principal balance, and I was spreading the word to a lot of homeowners about that. But one of the good things about what's happening is because we have a decrease in crime, which Chief Solomon did an excellent job with his men in blue. Let's give him a hand. At the press conference, crime is down. We have new homeowners coming in. We have a business boom happening in the city. And we are really seeing the revitalization of our city. And with that being said, property values are going up. People that live on the East End, they've seen significant property values increases, which means that you have more equity in your home. So when we look at the assessments increasing, there is a complicated formula, and we will be happy to talk about that and also to try to set some things up with Mrs. Mazuski. I do support the Protect Our Courts Act. I do protect the Good Cause Movement and all the things that are going on. I do understand Michelle Bosch and your concerns regarding free enterprise, regarding capital and understanding how to stay above water as a business owner and also as a business investor in our city. I think Councilwoman Mejia put it in a perfect terms, in terms of striking a balance in our city, in terms of finding that point of equilibrium where not only residents are happy, but our business owners and our investors are owners. And I always get coined for this phrase, finding that sweet spot, hearing all sides of the perspective and understanding where we can make those compromises. So we are working diligently in those efforts, and we're going to, I'm going to say one last point, if I may, municipal IDs. We're hoping to run and get those municipal IDs out in the first week of July. You know, hopefully we can get that happening. And I'm talking to the city manager, corporate counsel, and people in the office of the city clerk's office on how and what we need to continue to move and hopefully meet that deadline.
I forgot to say one thing, I'm sorry. Okay. There is a handout that Ileana has for those of you who weren't at the work session that explains the assessment process and how the taxes are figured. It's a very nice handout that our assessor made, and I forgot to mention that, but they've got copies here if anybody's interested in one.
There's copies at the front door next to the agenda this evening, and we have extra copies up here as well, too.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
So please don't give money to anyone unless you give it to the city clerk once we set up. ¿Cómo se dice lo en español para todos los gentes en this? Karen, can you please?
No, que hemos escuchado que hay personas que ya han tratado de empezar a vender las identificaciones y la aplicación de la ciudad de Newburgh. Solo les queríamos recordar a todas las personas que por favor no le den su dinero a ninguna persona. Tiene que ser en la oficina de acá del ayuntamiento, en las oficinas del city clerk que están en el primer piso. Nobody else, a ninguna otra persona. Please, don't give me money.
Yeah. Muchas gracias. Sí.
I mean, yeah.
Okay. So With that being said, that concludes our comments from the City Council regarding agenda and non-agenda items. We'll move on to the City Manager's report.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Resolution 104-2019, an agreement with CSX for impacts related to the replacement of the Walsh Road Bridge.
Do I have a motion for resolution number 104-2019?
So move.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Sklar's?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Resolution 105-2019, traffic signal upgrades for the Master Federal Aid Local Project Agreement.
Do I have a motion for, give me a second. Resolution number 105-2019.
So move.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Sklar's?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Resolution 106-2019, home rule request for police officer Samuel Keenan Jr.
Do I have a motion for resolution number 106-2019?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Sklar's?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Resolution 107-2019, fireworks contract.
Do I have a motion for resolution number 107-2019?
So move.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Sklar's?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Resolution 108-2019 for leak detection grant with the Orange County Water Authority.
Do I have a motion for resolution number 109-2019?
So move.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Sklar's?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Resolution 109-2019, transfer of 140 Chamber Street, 27 Johnson Street, and 43 Johnson Street.
Do I have a motion for number 109-2019?
So move.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
No.
Councilman Sklar's?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Resolution 110-2019, release of the restrictive covenants for 130 Johnson Street.
Do I have a motion for resolution number 110-2019?
So move.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Sklar's?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Resolution 111-2019, release of covenants for 53 Bencard Avenue.
Do I have a motion for resolution number 111-2019?
So move.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Sklar's?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Resolution 112-2019, satisfaction of judgments for 260 Liberty Street.
Do I have a motion for resolution 112-2019?
So move.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Sklar's?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Resolution number 113-2019, satisfaction of mortgage for 184 Broadway.
Do I have a motion for resolution number 113-2019?
So move.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Sklar's?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Resolution 114-2019, a reverter settlement for 56 Bencard Avenue.
Do I have a motion for resolution number 114-2019?
So move.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Squires?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Resolution number 115-2019, an update to the contractor list for the lead line replacement grant.
Do we have a motion for resolution number 115-2019?
So move.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Squires?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Resolution number 116-2019, good sports equipment donation for the Recreation Department.
Do I have a motion for resolution number 116-2019?
So move.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Squires?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Resolution 117-2019, Protect Our Courts Act, support this matter.
Do I have a motion for resolution number 117-2019?
So move.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Discussion. I just want to say that I want to be clear about this resolution, about all the other resolutions regarding housing in terms of, I know there was the issue of rent control and so on. Just be clear about the fact that when we pass a resolution regarding these matters, that it takes a state government and the state legislatures to do the same for certain things, right? So certain things the city government does not have jurisdiction to do. It's a state jurisdiction when we talk about protect our courts, you know, and with the rent control, that's a state jurisdiction. Where certain things like with the municipal ID, that's our jurisdiction. We can do the municipal ID, pass the resolution, and roll out those city IDs. But there are certain things that we'll do ceremonially and say, hey, if the city council is behind this legislation, and it's a state jurisdiction, we have to communicate, as this was stated earlier, with our representatives in the state legislature in Albany. So I just wanted to be very clear that certain jurisdiction is in the hands of the city government, and certain legislation and legislative jurisdiction is in the hands of the state government. And when we pass these types of resolutions that's not in our jurisdiction, it's a message, hopefully, to our state legislatures to do the same.
Also, I want to just comment on this resolution that we're passing. And what it means is that ICE officers cannot make an arrest inside the courthouse, and that's a city courthouse, without a judicial warrant or a signature from a federal judge.
Right.
Okay, so let's be clear.
Right.
No law enforcement action can be taken in a
right.
courtroom. All law enforcement officials have to identify themselves when they're entering a courthouse. So they need to let the courthouse personnel know that they are there, and they have to show ID so that they know when they step into that court and they can alert the judge. The court officers must notify the judge of any law enforcement agent present in the courthouse who intends to arrest a party or a participant. Court officers must also file an unusual occurrence report to record any law enforcement action taken in a courthouse. So by passing this resolution today, what we're doing is the Protect Our Courts Act will ensure that every immigrant and immigrant New Yorker can access the courts without fear of being picked up by ICE. Thank you.
So I'm going to ask Michelle Kelson, our legal expert, to weigh in on this just for a point of clarification on with the passing of this resolution, if this is a city jurisdiction and method, you know, do we need anything from the state government and state legislatures to protect our courts in the city in the city limits.
So this particular resolution is a resolution in support of a piece of legislation that's pending in front of our New York State Legislature. So the Protect Our Courts Act is an Assembly Bill number 2176, and it's a Senate Bill 425. And this resolution is just a decision of our local city council that it supports the state legislature's effort to enact this state bill that would do the things that Councilwoman Monteverdi has outlined.
Right. Thank you for that, because I want to be very clear. So this resolution is to support the existing legislation that's in the New York State Assembly and the New York State Senate. So in a sense, this resolution, if it passes, not making any assumptions, but if this resolution passes in our city council meeting, it's a ceremonial effort to tell and send a direct message to the state legislatures that we want this legislation done at the state level so that we are clear. Okay. Whereas when we pass that municipal ID law, we don't need the state to tell us to we're going to issue out state municipal IDs, because that's in our wheelhouse. That's what we are capable of doing at the city level. Okay. So just to be clear. Okay.
Can I just make a quick translation in Spanish? Lo que el alcalde estaba mencionando de la resolución que tenemos para proteger el sistema de las cortes es que es una resolución en apoyo, que la decisión tiene todavía que venir del Estado. O sea, que el senador y el asambleísta, con todos los que están en Albany, tienen que decidir que van a pasar esto. Nosotros lo que estamos haciendo es sometiendo una representación de esta ciudad que dice que eso es lo que queremos. So, pero tiene que todavía pasar al nivel del Estado.
Gracias. Mm-hmm. Okay, any other comments? Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice.
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia.
Sí.
Councilwoman Monteverde.
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford.
Yes.
Councilman Squires.
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles.
Yes.
Mayor Harvey.
Absolutely.
Approved.
Libertad. Right. All right.
Resolution 118-2019, paper carryout bag fee.
Do I have a motion for resolution number 118-2019?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Discussion.
Okay, discussion.
So first what I want to do is there were several people that helped me with this resolution, so I do want to give them their kudos. That was Ms. Kelson and Mr. Donat, because when the governor put this into law for March 2020, it was long. It was about 6 pages, and we had to do a little bit of a digging to get the exact one, because it was part of his other budget. I also want to thank Riverkeeper, who just feeds me a lot of information. I really just appreciate everything that they do for me and that we do together. I also want to thank the Quassaic Creek Watershed Alliance. They have also put out a similar letter to the county legislators and allowed us to mirror some of that language. I feel like I'm missing someone. If I missed you and you're watching, sorry. So really quickly, all of the research indicates that when you do just the plastic bag resolution without the 5-cent fee for the paper bags, it doesn't really have that big impact. And then for those people that are worried about what happens if they are on limited income or something like that, it excludes the people that are on SNAP or WIC. Also, 40% of that fee that the county will collect does come back into reusable bags. I believe in this issue so much that within the next coming weeks, I myself will be giving out reusable bags to people in the community, so please look forward to that. Ms. Kelson, did you want to add anything?
Just this is also a ceremonial resolution of sorts, and in this case, the City Council is supporting a piece of legislation in the county, Orange County legislature, that would be the responsible entity for imposing the paper carryout reduction fee. Right.
So I do want to add one more thing. We can protect our residents the same way that we protect our environment. And then that's it.
Thank you. If there are no other comments, we'll go for a roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Squires?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved?
Yes. I'm happy.
Resolution 119-2019 regarding a donation of trees.
Do I have a motion for resolution number 119-2019?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Squires?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Resolution 120-2019 to enact legislation on the state level to exempt from all real property taxes the granular activated carbon treatment facility, also known as the GAC treatment plant.
Do I have a motion for resolution number 120-2019?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Squires?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Ordinance number 5-2019 regarding the municipal ID fee ordinance.
Do I have a motion for city ordinance number 5-2019?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Quick discussion. I just want to give Michelle Kelson an opportunity, our corporate counsel, to give us some updates quickly, hopefully timeline.
I wish I could give you an exact date. We have to order the equipment necessary to produce those municipal ID cards. Once that equipment has been ordered, then we'll be able to actually issue a timeline, because okay. We'll hopefully have a delivery date, and we can then back into delivery, installation, and testing so that we can actually announce a date on which the first municipal IDs will be issued. But I just want to reiterate, because I was very concerned of what I heard during public comment, the city of Newburgh is not ready to issue these municipal IDs today. Please do not give your money to anybody outside of City Hall. That's critical. If somebody approaches you on the street, they are not working for the city of Newburgh. Money and application, we will have a form and a checklist and instructions for you. And the only place that you'll be able to obtain those IDs is here in City Hall. So please tell your friends and your neighbors to be a little more patient and to hold on to your money.
Thank you. Any other comments?
Over the last several weeks, we have obviously been identifying the best technology and equipment to purchase, and looking into the funding for that. So once those matters are processed accordingly, we obviously will have a better time frame.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you guys for your hard work. Roll call, please.
Councilman Grice?
Aye.
Councilwoman Mejia?
Yes.
Councilwoman Monteverde?
Yes.
Councilwoman Rayford?
Yes.
Councilman Squires?
Yes.
Councilwoman Sophocles?
Yes.
Mayor Harvey?
Yes.
Approved.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. City Manager, for your update. And we will go to old business, if there's any old business.
I do have one old business. I guess it's kind of old. Can I have what is our timeline on getting a communication strategist?
A few people have been identified. And we could talk further offline if you'd like.
Okay, thank you.
Also, as an old business item, I do want to say, publicly thank you to Mr. Garrison, who is working diligently to start phase one of the road repavement, as we had mentioned before. I'm really excited about it, although it's in the East End. We are excited.
That's right, the East End.
Yeah, East End. We're hoping it gets to the Heights, and I think that's in its phase two plan. But What's super important that I think Mr. Garrison and DPW need to be acknowledged and congratulated for is the fact that notices have already been posted. We've done a press release from the city manager's office and DPW, and road repavement is going to start in May. And I don't think in the years that I've been on council that that has ever happened. It probably hasn't happened in 50 years, but I know at least since my tenure on the council, he's starting in May. And I really, really want to say thank you, Mr. Garrison, for doing that, because we know that's not an easy undertaking, particularly this time of the year with all the other work that DBW in terms of our parks and getting those things ready for the spring and summer. I've also, with that effort, have been in ongoing dialogue with our city manager, some of our city council members with the street sweeper program. We have identified a few non-for-profit organizations, I won't put that out there yet, who are very much involved and in exciting about the street sweeper initiative, so that in the spring and summer months we can hire local residents to help us keep our streets clean and our parks clean. After particularly the effort of Safe Homes and the citywide street citywide cleanup that happened in April while I was recovering from surgery, so we want to keep that effort in alignment with the infrastructural work that's ongoing: roads, ADA compliant curbs, keeping the city streets cleaned, our parks cleaned, and also with the ongoing work with the water sewage separation. All that is infrastructural work to continue to revitalize our city. So anything else on old business?
I'm going to keep on bringing this up about the forensic audit, which we voted on in March of 2016, and here it is May of 2019. We can find the money, and I don't think it's fair to Mr. Todd Bennings that he's in the department and he's finding a lot of things that somebody need to be held accountable for, and I don't think it's fair to him coming into a place with the other employees, you know, in a state of shock and wonder of monies, how the city has spent it, don't know where it is. So I'm going to keep bringing that up until it happens. So also the other thing is the skateboard park, and I know that was mentioned months ago about I guess the people being part of having that skateboard park named after some youth and those who were involved. I haven't heard anything, so.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, that's a something that we gotta revisit. I know in terms of the forensic audit, Todd, Mr. Venning, our comptroller, had mentioned at the previous meeting that his office was wrapping up with the general audit that happens every year with
Davies O'Connor.
Davies and O'Connor. And that once that audit, that $80,000 audit is wrapped up, we're going to be looking to find funding for a forensic audit.
Okay.
So.
Sounds good.
Yes.
And as far as the skateboard park being named after the young people, I think that's something we definitely want to have on the agenda for the for
just
the
as year. A reminder, we talked about a moratorium on naming.
Oh, that's right.
And we Michelle kindly gave us the New Orleans resolution. I have been trying to get through it. I think everybody needs to go back to that. Just, you know, want to remind folks that we won't be naming anything until we all are in agreement with a resolution. Thanks.
Thank you for that reminder.
We have to know about the parks. We know about the buildings and the street naming. We need to know about the parks.
Okay, Councilman Sklarz, you had something?
I just needed some clarification on the Lake Street Bridge replacement project. It's been brought to my attention that pedestrian access may also be cut off during that construction.
Yeah, so the we recently had to close the Lake Drive Bridge due to structural deficiencies. pedestrians can still cross that bridge, but it's closed to vehicular traffic. When that bridge goes under construction, the entire bridge will be removed, and there will be no pedestrian access across that bridge. So buses and whatnot will have to pick up people on the other side. And I think that was talked about a little bit in the Transportation Committee meetings about
how long is that?
That construction period?
Yeah.
That will likely go from the end of the summer of 2019 through 2020.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
It's going to be very important that we let those residents know. So the same how we did the street paving press release today, that same for those residents.
Yeah, that same communication.
We did send out a press release about the closing of the bridge. When we approach the construction season for it, we will be sure to do so as well, too.
As it is, these folks are cut off or have limited access to bus transportation. Not to be able to walk in that direction is going to further cut off that population.
So really the question I have is that the other end of Lake Street, and I guess it's near
Lake Drive,
Lake Street, that mm-hmm. they both intersect right there by independent living. Yep. There's a swoop underneath that bridge, so somehow they would have to, if they're going to go through Lake Street, they would have to come out by the two elderly homes. There's Sarone Place and Burton Towers.
Right.
And not through the other way, because that has to be cut off too, because it can't take the weed. Am I correct?
That is the
truth.
Okay. Right. The bridge that dips down, the Lake Drive Bridge.
Okay.
Right. So, because I was under the, I thought it was the bridge that we have at Lake Street on the end where Planned Parenthood is. So that's fine, right?
The temporary structure in place is still structurally sound.
Right. So that
Lake
one is
Street
fine.
Is
that's
Lake
where the
drive is the bridge that was red flagged by State DOT,
which is going to the Lake Street apartments.
Correct.
On the other side near independent living.
Correct.
Okay. Yeah. Gotcha.
So just to add to that, Bob, Councilmember Bob Sklarz did ask the transportation company to look at bringing buses through there, but they could not fit, I believe is what it was. And then on Saturday, Councilmember Monteverdi, Councilmember Sklarz, and I participated in the Yale Day of Service, where we looked at Lake Street and how to make it a complete street situation.
Yeah, it was great to walk through and just, you know, experience it as a pedestrian. And it's actually right now the way that it's the traffic flows, it's not safe. And we have to, I think the priority and the goal is to make it more pedestrian friendly and safe, and there's a way to do that. So it was very helpful to do that and participate and see the possibilities.
So I'll just bring once those notes are consolidated, we'll be bringing forth a few of those quick things that we can do to help that situation.
Also, is there a possibility that the private owner of the Lake Street apartments, could they buy those roads from us so that we won't have to maintain them?
That's a rather complicated issue that we could talk about further.
You can't compel somebody to buy the streets. There is a process for discontinuing those streets.
Okay.
But you know, if somebody else isn't going to be prepared to pick up the maintenance, then discontinuing is probably not a good option.
Right. Also,
tried.
Mr. Garrison, I've gotten a number of calls regarding Lake Drive, and I know we had a rough winter. I know you and I and Mr. Donuts have had ongoing conversations about the potholes, and your guys went and filled those holes like several times, multiple times this season. Is that in phase two?
Yes.
Okay, so that's in phase two. Great. Okay.
There'll be two pavings taking place this summer. We're about to commence the first
phase
first
one.
Of two.
Yeah. Right. Okay. Great.
If I recall, you're going to start soon. And you should complete it by the end of June, phase one, right? Correct?
Correct.
Beginning of June, right?
Beginning of June,
phase one.
Good.
We're going to start with some ADA work on some of phase two, so
Right. And you listed all the streets.
Yep.
Then you'll move on to phase two and list all the streets as well.
Exactly.
Okay.
And then there's a phase 2.5.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
If we're lucky.
If we're lucky.
And George and his team used more than 400 tons of asphalt to repair potholes this past winter.
Yep.
So obviously, the work that they do is around the clock and endless, and always worth thanking him for his
absolutely
dedication.
Thank you, guys. Okay, so we're going to move on to new business, if there's any new business.
Yes, I do have some new business. Some time ago, Mr. Donat and a few of the other people, we have talked about double-side parking on Lower Washington Street. So I wanted to know if that was going to be happening. I was hoping that it could happen fairly soon. So for the, if you wasn't privy to that conversation, on the going east on Washington Street, it's the same width, I believe. And on one side, it's a double side of the parking, but then on the other side, there isn't. I believe there's been some data gathered about that situation and what we can do for that.
So the engineering department did go out and measure it. The next step is going to be, that's a fire access road.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're gonna put up some of the plastic delineator posts at the ends of the stalls, and the firemen will be able to take those turns in the truck and the engine and make sure that they can take that so we can see where, how that'll lay out. So that'll be the next steps with that.
Thank you.
Since we got Mrs. Church on online, Allie, are you doing a presentation on Friday at Stewart? And if so, can you please tell us?
Yes, like many of you, I was asked to participate in a project called Aerial Futures on Friday. I don't have a lot of details on it. I it's at Atlas Industries. I believe it starts at
9 a.m.
At 9 a.m. It goes through much of the day, and there's a group of practitioners talking about connecting the city of Newburgh to Stewart Airport, kind of long-term thinking about that. It's also, my understanding, is in conjunction with an architecture studio that reimagined the short line bus station on 17K. And so there'll be that presentation at 11:30 if people are interested in seeing that. But it's throughout the day at Atlas Industries. However, we'll add, I am a participant, not an organizer. So like many of you, I have some questions about the details, and I will be getting them, and I will make sure to circulate it to Mr. Donat so that he can circulate to all of you. And
yes.
I apologize for the confusion.
No, Ms. Church and I have spoken about this, and the organization that's putting on the meeting has certainly made it a point to communicate to the city their interest in, of our involvement. Obviously, Ms. Church could be there at the beginning as asked by the organization. However, her time may not be obligated fully that day to the entire event that's taking place.
I'm really excited about that. Thank you both for that communication, and thank you for participating. I know Councilman Grice and the Transportation Committee is definitely going to appreciate any efforts moving in that direction, because we were and still are hoping and envisioning on how to enhance or create a robust transportation system for our city.
By all means.
That connects us to Stewart and even Metro North Line. So
sure.
Please do what you do, and thank you for it.
The city's fully engaged in that process.
Yes, sir. Okay. Anyone else for new business?
Yes, I have one thing. I would like to, again, hope that the city employees will get together for the summer like we did for the, Christmas, Hanukkah, and all that other celebration. We'll get together this summer like we did last summer, just to boost the morale of being employed and like we did. I think it was very good that we keep this up.
Absolutely. Okay. Thank you. If there's no other new business items, we'll go on to our final comments from the City Council. And I want to encourage everyone to be brief. We're approaching the 9 o'clock hour.
Yes.
Councilman Grice.
I am going to be brief. It did come back to my remembrance, two people that I forgot, and so I want to publicly thank them, and that was Mana Jo Green, who just does a lot for our environment, and I just really enjoy her. It was also Nick Page, our Dutchess legislator, because they did pass something like this over in Dutchess, and he's just a good friend and a good resource to me. The other thing is, I know I called for it in our beginning comments, is I will be looking to see if we can do a full reevaluation citywide. I think that's really appropriate.
I just mention?
Yes, please.
Because the city assesses at full market value, there is a regular cyclical reevaluation period that the city engages in, mm-hmm. and 2020 will be that full revaluation year.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yes, that helps. Thank you for that.
Yep.
And then since it's 2020.
Thank you, Councilman Grice. Councilwoman Mejia.
No, I just wanted to thank everybody for coming out. Muchísimas gracias a todos ustedes también que están continuando a venir a las reuniones. De verdad que tiene un impacto tenerlos a ustedes acá. Como ven, las conversaciones son de todos, de lo que está pasando en el vecindario a lo que está pasando al nivel estatal. What I would also then just add is that it's really important for individuals to continue to come and participate in the city council meetings. There is definitely an emergency when it comes to our housing stock situation. And to quote Mayor Harvey, we have to continuously struggle to find that sweet spot so that there is a balance between tax-paying parcels, taxpayers, folks who are renters, folks who are visitors. And I would just, like to make the plea once again that we have to also be cautious of the language that we use when we're having those conversations, just because I think it's respectful it's important to be respectful with one another, knowing that we have a very diverse community here in the city of Newburgh. And you don't know what individuals are going through in their own personal world. So, extremadamente importante que todos continuemos a venir a estas reuniones, de tener un discurso que sea positivo y un discurso que sea respetable. Por favor, continúen informando al concejal de cualquier tópico que están teniendo en sus vidas, especialmente de transportación, de inmigración y de viviendas. Sé que hay familias que están esperando que nosotros terminemos acá para tener conversaciones. Y de verdad que les digo que lo más difícil es nosotros encontrar apartamentos que sean de calidad humana para que las personas puedan vivir. So thank you guys for coming, and we will see you at our next meeting, which is the work session on Thursday.
Oh, Wednesday.
Thursday?
We're hoping to.
We didn't talk about it.
Yeah, hopefully,
so,
hopefully, right.
To me, it's still on Thursday.
Okay. All right, Councilwoman Monteverde.
Thanks. I'll make this quick. Want to just make an announcement that this coming Sunday, May 19th, we're having our annual off-Broadway run at Safe Harbors. So if you're a runner, please come and join us. And I know that the mayor's going to kick it off. So.
Tell us the date and time again.
Sunday at, what time is it? 9 o'clock, I think, right? We kick it off?
Yeah.
I think. I better get back to you on that.
Yep.
So there's a lot of good things going on in the city today. And I think, I've been observing and going to wonderful events and meetings. And, for example, this past weekend, we had just talked Councilman Grice about the Reimagine Lake Street corridor, and that was really great that the Yale alumni, the architects, came. They volunteered and they facilitated this discussion on the design, and Allie Church was there and she gave a great discussion about it as well. So, again, there's good things going on. After that, I went to the Atlas Market, which was actually quite an amazing event. over at Atlas, and it's really amazing what they have done over in that area in the city of Newburgh. So there's really wonderful things going on in the city, and at the same time, I feel like we're going through growing pains right now with the reevaluation, people questioning that. I, for one, my property went up 20%. I'm kind of glad. But I know that for some it's a hardship and concerning, and I want to say that we need to continue to look at that and make sure that we are, that the assessor is assessing property and it's fair across the board for everyone. So I know that if we continue to talk about it and communicate, we'll get to a point where, you know, we understand it and we understand the process, and you know, hopefully it'll be uniform, just like Councilman Grice is asking. So thank you. Thanks for coming out tonight, and I'll see you at the work session.
Councilwoman Rayford.
Thank you. I just want to bring to everyone's attention that we are having the African American Parade and Festival June 8th and 9th, and we're looking for vendors to help us celebrate. Also, a deep concern and important issue that I come across daily is that we have hungry children in our schools, in which the only meals that they receive is the ones that we give in the schools, breakfast and lunch, but they go hungry the whole weekend, and some of them don't eat a good meal. They go and they, however they make it, they come back and they're very, very hungry. So if you have any non-perishable food items, please see me. I will give it to the kids. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilman Sklars.
Since our last meeting, we had the citywide cleanup event chaired by Councilwoman Monteverde. It was a wonderful event. A lot of folks participated, and as they said, tons of trash were picked up, and it's really good to see the city pull together like that. Last week, Wednesday or Thursday, I forget, we attended the press conference on the significant drop in crime stats by the city. And, you know, we can't commend that enough. It's a wonderful news for the city. And those of us who walk for exercise or walk city streets every day, we've been feeling it over the years that there are streets that, you know, were problem areas in the past that are no problems now because of the good work you guys do. And thank you for that. Thank you for coming out tonight. That's it.
Thank you. Councilwoman Sophocles.
I'll be real quick, too. I just want to remind everybody that the Downing Park Shelter House is open. I had Mother's Day brunch there yesterday. It was beautiful. And also the monument will be going up this week, and all the lights will be replaced around the park. And so there's a lot of things going on in the whole city. And I also want to remind you about Newburgh Illuminated. That has become like the premier event of the city in Newburgh. It brings thousands of people into the city, and the attention that it brings this city is unbelievable. And I want to encourage everybody to go there on June 1st, right out here, from 12 to 10 p.m. And also remember Partisan Fontaine, who is from the city of Newburgh, and it has become quite famous, is going to be here as an entertainer.
Absolutely. Thank you, Councilwoman Sophocles. I think she yields the remaining of her time to me. Just kidding. Just kidding. I always wanted to say that. They do that in the Congress. Anyway.
I'll start using my whole 3 minutes.
No, but I wanted to say thank you to everyone for coming out tonight. I really liked Councilwoman Monteverde's comment about growing pains. I know that there are times when we have tough conversations. I wanted to mention, I know Hannah Brooks is already gone, but she had sent me an email with some important data that she and a group of people have gathered regarding the equity in the unequal assessments in their view. And I'm going to be meeting with them. I'm going to welcome a couple council members to join us so that we can look at the numbers, because men lie, women lie, the numbers don't lie, right? And so I definitely want to see, and I've looked over some of them, and I want to make sure that things are being done equitably and done evenly for all single-family homeowners. I do want to remind our constituents and our residents, there were 2 years ago, before I became a mayor, we did decrease tax liability for the city residents who were homesteaders. And there are opportunities, hopefully in the near future, that we can continue to decrease, particularly for homesteaders who own homes. And if we can do it for investors as well in the near future, we want to do that. But the key thing is, which is a serious point of contention, we have ongoing efforts to look at the data on who's paying their taxes and who's not. So if we have 35% homeowners in our city, you know, we really want to know that number. How many of that 35% are paying, and how many are in tax foreclosure or in the MRIM process? Also with the investors and also with other folks that own property. Councilwoman Sophocles and I have that ongoing conversation. If everyone paid their taxes, you know, on time, like most of us do, we can get the taxes to go down, you know, and that's something that we got to think about as well as putting new homes and properties on board that were abandoned. We've had the most abandoned buildings sold and put back on the tax roll in 2018 than they've done, that this city has done in over 50 years. That's a fact. Okay, so revitalization is happening. Crime is down. We're seeing the city turn its corner. Property values are up. We get new homeowners. You know, I got a new homeowner right across the street from me, you know, and they've already done work in 3 weeks to fix up their houses. And a lot of people say, well, Mayor Harvey, you know, we heard you don't like landlords. We love landlords. We love people who invest in our city, but we don't want slumlords who won't bring their properties up to code. So, again, thank you all for coming out tonight. Meeting adjourned.